Hello everyone, back again for the third part, which will be the main part actually. The two first parts were more introductions to the interest of plant phenotyping, and the second part was okay, we're going to process images from images which have been acquired by cameras, but there might be some elements which are important for you to know about how to simplify your life in picking up the good camera for the good application, optimizing a little bit the light, and that was why we wanted to include this as part of the course. But the main part of the course is now to come in, and it's based on the image processing. We will teach you how to process images and sequence of images for various plant phenotyping applications. So there are mainly three steps in what we call image processing pipeline, where you have first images which have been acquired and maybe are not exactly perfect, and so you would like to correct for any artifacts, any noise which you have not been able to correct before. Of course, as we say, garbage in, garbage out. If you did not pay enough effort to reduce the noise, it's really a shame, because you can undo it, indeed try to reduce it afterwards, but it's never as good as if you had withdrawn this noise before. So please pay attention to remove any artifacts, any errors, any disturbance, any noise that are going to bother you later. However, in this first step, we will try to somehow reduce, cancel as much as we can the remaining possible noise. Then there is a second step where we will, from this nice image corrected from any artifacts, we will try to enhance only the part of the image we are interested in. So we will, for instance, if we in this scene with this lady, we want to highlight if there is a presence of a person or not, we might be interested in highlighting the edges in the image. And if there is strong edges, then decide if we are going to, we estimate that there is one person or no person, nobody in front of the camera. So this is the last step, taking the decision based on the image which has been enhanced, enhancing only the patterns of interest in the image. So we call this first step the low level, so enhancement, correction of the sensor. The second step, middle level, morphometric feature extraction, so we will enhance only the part of the image we are interested in. And the last level, which is called high level, measurement on these features as estimation detection. So in the end, we end up with, for instance, on the detection or classification. So if you want to say, okay, there is a weed, or there is a useful crop, or if there is disease or non-disease, this is a classification binary task. And you have only you can only store this information on only one bit, 0 or 1. While at the beginning you had a huge amount of data with an image which could be 512 pixels by 512 pixels, which is a huge amount of bits and information, and you reduce it to only what you want to extract from the images. So the data size decreases as you go from low level to high level. But the semantic value increased, meaning that in the end, at the beginning, you had only an image. You don't know, you as a human can have a look, but the computer doesn't know anything about it. And in the end, the computer learns about, for instance, deciding if there is one person or no person in the scene. So we're going in this course to go through all these different levels of the image processing pipelines. But first, we have to highlight of why we are interested in computer vision and compare it to human vision. So computer visions have interest, but also limitations. For instance, computer vision, here, when we look at this scene, we see a kind of triangle, but this triangle is not visible to the computer vision. Why do we see a triangle? Because our mind has been grown up in a world where when you have straight lines, even if there is something hiding the continuation of the straight line, we will continue this straight line as a kind of, yes, habit to have continuity of straight lines, even if there is a hole behind the object which is occluding something. So here, even if we don't see anything, we imagine this, that there is a triangle here. The computer vision is like a newborn to this world and doesn't know this kind of rules, so it will not see the triangle. Here, our eye see the limit of a circle when as you go apart from the scene, but if you zoom in, you don't see any limit of the circle. So this limit is built by your own mind, and the computer will not be able to see it if we don't help him in seeing this. So we have to tell him somehow what he has to see. So this is two cases. These are two cases where situations where the computer vision will in fact do less than a human vision, which is not new to this world. Especially for you as biologists, when you will look at an image, you will see some words and not only pixels. You will see petiole. You will see leaves. You will see a lot of details that the computer is not capable of interpreting at first sight. But on the other hand, there are situations where the computer will do much better than any human vision. For instance, here, if you have to count objects in a large number of time, human will get tired of doing this, while the computer, if it's properly trained to do it, will not get tired of anything and will have a kind of errors, a level of errors which will stay steady along with time, while human will go tired of this, and their number of errors will grow up with time. Also, if you want to estimate some dimensions in an image, you may be aware that actually your sensitivity to dimensions are not the same whether objects are orthogonal or horizontal. So if you take these two lines and you put them side by side, then you will realize that the one which is vertical, which looks to you actually longer than the horizontal one, is actually smaller. Yeah. So you cannot be confident on estimating anything with your human eye from a quantitative point of view. And that's the same also for gray levels. Here, these two gray levels, this one appear on the inside rectangle. The one on the right appears darker than the one on the left, while actually the both have the same gray levels. Your human brain is influenced by the surrounding background on the perception of the gray level. So we have seen interest and limitation of computer vision, and what we understood is that we need to help a bit the computer so that we can get benefit of the quantitative power of the computer in order to address repetitive quantitative tasks that human eye will not be able to do properly in many different situations. Also, another power of computer vision compared to the human vision is that we have, as we have recalled, the human vision somehow, it can see only what it has under its own table or several meters or something like this. So if you want to see things from a larger point of view, like observing, for instance, with the remote sensing, with satellite images, details, then your human eye cannot see it from the ground, and you are very happy to have high-scale resolution. Imagine where the computer will see the big picture, but also all the narrow details, while your human eye will not be able to detect all the small island and the small details that you have on the shore in this huge image. Of course, if we zoom in, we will be able to see the details, but from the global image itself, the computer will be able to process it at all, while our human eye is not capable of extracting because it's too much scales and resolution in the image. Also, there are situations where cameras give contrasts which are outside of our human eye, and so the camera will produce images that human eyes are not used to observe and to interpret. And in this case, we are somehow newborns, human and computer, at the same level. And so it's interesting to use the computer vision to process these images. Last and not least, our human eye is capable of distinction of dynamic scenes when they are not moving too slow, not moving too fast. And so for high speed process, this can be very useful to have the help of computer vision to analyze data. And even if we are on very slow speed movements, that no human would stay if you observe this decently, and you can leave a camera and a computer to monitor processes, small processes like growth of plants. And this is something that you will uncover a new phenomenon for plants. We will have occasion to study this in the exercise and the mini project that I will provide you. And in this case, again, computer vision is very nice when human patience somehow is not enough to follow very slow processes. So now, after this introduction on the power and limitation of computer vision, let's move in what is a digital image. So actually, we have different types of digital images. We have the gray level intensity images. We have the binary images, where there is only two types of level, 0 and 1, and the color images. And so we will go in detail on all these type of images. So images, as we see like this, looks like object, but if we zoom in, we will see this matrix, and which include actually a number which corresponds to the gray level. So if the number is high, then we will have a bright gray level. If the number is low, we will have a dark gray level. Color images actually are based on three gray level images, which are concatenated. So one gray level image is in red, one gray level image is in green, and one gray level image is in blue. So actually everything is about intensity level, but the size of the image and the number of levels are different. If you are on intensity gray level, where you have only one image with gray level, which can move from 0 to a certain number. Binary image, where you have only two levels. And color images, where you have three gray level images, which are concatenated. So this is more or less illustrated here, where on the intensity level, you have this gray level, which is then encoded in binary inside the inside the computer. So for instance, here on the gray level coded on 3 bits, you will have 2^3, meaning 8 possible level. And in most images, you will have 2^8 gray levels, so moving from 0 to 255, because this will make 256 level. For binary image, you have only 1 bit, so it's coding on 2^1 levels. And for color images, you have 3 images of gray levels coded on RGB, coding on 8 bit, so 2^8. Levels. So that's the type of structure of digital images that you have. So for RGBs, actually, if you split these three channels, the gray level in red, the gray level in green, and the gray level in blue, this you have a stack of these three channels. There are other color spaces existing, and we will come back to it later. One way to analyze how gray levels evolve in an image is to plot a profile. So you have an example here. If you plot a profile of the gray levels, you will see that in this dark white part, it will be rather high, close to 255, 200 here. Then you come into the object, which is black. So we'll drop almost to zero, not exactly, 25 here. Then you will have objects which move very fast, so a lot of fluctuation. And then you come back to the background, which is here. And this is another example with another image. So you should be able to interpret such such evolution of gray levels, which are very useful to see if you have a contrast. Here, the contrast that we were talking about in a previous video is very strong between the background and the object. For instance, you are 200 gray levels and then you drop to 25. So it's something like 180 variance of variation of gray level, which is very, very strong. If you see that when you look for an intensity profile in an image and you see a very small drop, it means that maybe your human eye is seeing something like just like the triangle in the previous slides, but actually this contrast is very slow, and it will be very difficult for very small, and it will be very difficult for the computer to be able to quantitatively extract any information from this small contrast. In terms of color spaces, so we were saying that actually for RGB image, then for each pixel, we have one red, one green, one blue. So it's like X, Y, Z coordinates, and there is a way of representing these gray levels in a color cube like this here. And you will see that there is, in the end, 255 by 266 by 266 by 266 cells in this cube. And this is 16 million colors that we always talk of when we're talking about color images. So here you have the black point where you have 0, 0, 0. Here you have the red point where you have so red, green, blue, so 255, 0, 0. Here you have the blue point where you have red, green, blue, so 0, 0, 255, 255. And then you have the green point where you have 0, 255, 0. And you will have the yellow, the magenta, and the cyan part, which are the other corner of the cube. Here we have the white point where we have 255, 255, 255, which is the point where all gray levels are at the maximum value for each channel, red, green, and blue. You can transform color images into other additional color spaces. So this is mathematical transformation. We don't give the detail itself, but we may use these color spaces in some situation. So one of them is called a hue saturation and luminance color space. So the dominant wavelength, so the dominant color will be in the hue. The contribution, the amount of this color will mean the saturation, and the intensity by surface unit is the luminance. So if you are on in your room and you have some wall with a main color, it might be the case that due to the non-even illumination, you will have a variation of intensity. And this variation of intensity in an RGB image will be translated in a variation in red, green, and blue. While here, in this case, variation of intensity will only impact only the luminance. So that if you have uneven illumination, it can be good to use hue or saturation to prevent from a variation of intensity. So very useful when you are working in a non-controlled condition, like in field or in greenhouse conditions. Another color space, so actually the HSL and LAB, the second color space, are mathematically computed from the RGB. So everything comes from the RGB because that this is where it comes from the sensors. Okay? Okay, so and now if you do a mathematical transformation to switch to HSL or to switch to LAB, you will have access to another properties, other properties of this color space. So the LAB color space also has a kind of intensity, so it's called lightness, and A and B are two colors. And this color space is very useful when you want to do some metric of distance between colors, because your human eye is not capable of distinguishing in a democratic way the difference between colors. You will have more sensibilities to distinct variation of greens than any variation of blue or red. So while in the LAB space, if you compute a distance of discrimination between two lights in the green, in the blue, or in the red, you will have the same sensitivity of this variation of color, of sensitivity of color. So it really corresponds to how it closely corresponds to how the human eye is perceiving the colors. So these variations of colors, these various color spaces can be used to optimize the contrast. For instance, here you have an RGB image, and we can have a look at red, green, blue image, HSV image, or LAB image, and maybe you, by looking at this, you will realize that some of this channel in this stack of images are more interesting than others. For instance, here the saturation channel or the B channel are very well contrasted between the crops and the background, so it will be maybe interesting to use this channel to process the images if we are interested in counting the plant or in segmenting the leaf or analyzing their shape. So I come to a last type of imaging that I did not talk about, is that you can have fake color images. So this is typically what you have when you are looking at a thermal image, and that you give fake color, like blue will correspond to cold part of the image, or and hot will correspond to some reddish part of the image. So this is typically what you will have in a lookup table, a color palette of type of fire. So any gray level images can be colorized by converting each gray level to a given color. So there is the gray level lookup table, which is this panel. When you have zero, you are black. When you have 255, you are white, and all possible variants in between. But you can change this association of color and decide that when you have zero, you have dark blue, and when you have 255, you have dark, high, light red, and everything in between, and so make gray level images colorful. So this is what we have here from an RGB image, and make it look like a fire, a thermal, and so on. So it can be used more for, let's say, visibility of to enhance visibility to the human eye, but you have to be aware that somehow you're just tricking the brain by using adapted color to the human eye so that he better sees details. For instance, here at a microscopic level, you have some kind of cells, and you barely see the surrounding cytoplasm in when you look lookup table, which is green. While if you change the lookup table and make it hot green, you will see all the details. But basically, none of the contrasts that were in the image are more present on the right part, on the right image, than on the left image. It's just that they are more visible to your human eye. So it's useful when you want to enhance something, but if you want to do something quantitative, this has nothing to do with it. It's more for, nice images or website images, but not for science. Same here with this blue image, where you on the lookup table blue, where you have only variation of gray level transmitted in terms of blue, and when you move to fire, then you would see only the inner part of the cell and all the core of the shell of the cell. And if you change the lookup table, then you see the inside part of the cell and the surrounding cytoplasm much much better. But again, it's just for the eye. The contrast was already present in the beginning, but not maybe visible with this choice of lookup table. One very important point when we talk about images is the format of the digital images. There are many of them: JPEG, JPEG 2000, PNG, GIF, TIFF, BMP, and so on. So the main characteristic intrinsic to a format and its status in relation to patents are their free format or owner format. So for instance, JPEG 2000, which was a very nice proposal, was something private and never open to being free format. And so even if it's the best format that had ever been proposed, actually it's not used at all because people want free format. Number of colors supported. So some are restricting the amount of colors. That's the case of GIF, which is only supporting 256 colors. And also very important stuff is about data compression. Do we have a lossless or lossy compression? And that's the case of JPEG. So a lot of images that come in for scientific use are using JPEG, and this is very bad. Please don't use it, because there is a compression which is lossy, meaning that there are some details in the image that could be lost due to this compression. So the best format that you could use to start with when you are starting a scientific project is to use TIFF or BMP and nothing else. So, for instance, here, if you want to do some scientific analysis, maybe use TIFF or RAW format of your image. If you want to do some web page, you can use some compressed images to avoid overloading your web page. If you want to propose some stack imaging, meaning that actually when you load an image, actually you have a stack of image, very useful when you have a temporal follow-up of a process, then TIFF or GIF will do it. That's the animated GIF that you can maybe used before. And also these are the information about the possibility of using videos. Another important stuff is about converting imaging. When you will be processing imaging, you might encounter the need to convert an image to a given format, from a given format to another format. So basically a certain number of bits to another number of bits. So if you want to move from, for instance, a certain number of bits, like let's say that 16, 32 bits to a smaller number of bits, you have to be aware that actually you will not be perceiving anything because your human eye is only capable of perceiving 200 gray levels. So this is why we use actually 8 bits gray level as a reference, because 8 bits, as we said, is 2 power of 8, so 256 gray level. While if you were using 7 bits, 2 to the power of 7, it will be, so 256 divided by 2, 128, so it's less. It will be less than the 200 gray level that you can see. So if you have a 16-bit camera or a 32-bit camera, there are some details in the image that your human eye is not capable of seeing. So you have to be aware of this, because when you do this, it's interesting because you reduce the size of your image, but the data storage need for your image, but you will not see the difference, while actually some details may be very relevant for quantitative analysis that the computer itself could be capable of interpreting. In some other cases, we might need to go from 8 bits to a higher number of bits, and in this case, you will see nothing and there will be nothing lost. It's just a trick that is sometimes used to enable calculation that requires more memory. We'll see this later. Everything in this course will be illustrated by Imagy software, which has been introduced in the 90s. It has been funded by public US research, and I will give you a demo of this software later in other videos. So, here is a time for a first a break and hands-on to see how to calibrate